What's wrong?
Frozen shut. Of course.
Oh, there he goes.
Sean!
There goes Chris.
Look.
Help him. There you go. It was him doing it all along, not Chris. But Chris is gonna think he did it. Whoa. Yeah, they did wave.
Did you see that?
See what?
See what? We just got here. Are you okay?
Yeah. I didn't see anything either.
Okay. I just fell down into the snow. Dad says I'm kind of clumsy.
That's an awesome costume. Who's your favorite superhero? I love Power Bear.
Oh, man! I have the Mega Power Bear. You should check it out.
Dude, that's so cool.
Chris, oh, God. Look, I am so sorry. Are you okay?
Dad, I'm fine. I promise.
Are you sure? Listen, I shouldn't... Do you know them?
It's okay, Dad. They're cool. He loves superheroes, even Power Bear.
Ah, gotcha. Hey there. Are you staying with the Reynolds?
Yeah, our grandparents.
Oh, yeah. They're our grandparents.
I see. Oh, geez, Chris. You don't have any damn shoes on. I'm sorry, buddy. Let's get you inside.
You have shoes on?
Yeah. Okay, Dad.
Thanks, guys. Oh, and, if Claire asks, tell her everything is fine.
Is it?
Is it? Really?
Never mind. See you around.
Sure.
He ran out with his socks.
Thanks, guys. See you later.
Yes, we will.
Daniel, did you forget everything about the rules already?
Sorry, Sean. Did you want me to let him fall? Really?
I can see this.
No, you... You did the right thing. But listen, we can't let anybody know. We have to keep a low profile out here.
He's like my age. I bet you would have done the same exact thing. Don't be mad.
I'm not mad, dude. It's over. Daniel, remember that we're hiding out. So no training and no showing off your power. From now on, you stick with me. All the time, okay?
That is interesting, the way it ties together with the prelude. I wonder if we'll see them again. Chris or his father. Very intimidating looking. Beaver Creek, Oregon. I'm at the neighbors.
Oh, fuck. That kid never listens.
I guess we will see them again. Alright, guys, stand by. I'll be right back. Okay.
Okay. Time to get Daniel at the Ericsons.
And what will we find there, I wonder? Move the bag. New picture. He wrote that quickly. December what? 10th. What the hell, Daniel? The first rule. What was this kid running away from? And did his father say something? Does he have other things in... Oh no, Daniel's inventory from here too. Okay, never mind.
I should get dressed to go look for Daniel.
Oh, I'll get dressed again? Okay. Well, when we were on the run, we slept in our clothes because it was so cold. Now I gotta keep taking them on and off. It's so inconvenient. Because of this imposing thing.
Claire? Steven? Anybody home?
No.
Well, looks like I'm home alone.
We don't want to look at anything today?
Oh, right. Sunday morning. Claire and Steven must be at church.
Oh. Well, at least they don't insist that we go. You know, he's supposed to stay in the house, actually. And now he's gone next door.
Dude, move your ass. Who knows what Daniel's doing over there?
Now we're gonna read a note first.
Well, I guess they won't be back for at least 2 hours.
Morning, sleepyheads. We let you sleep in today while we're at church. Be back at noon for lunch. See you in a bit. Love, Grandma and Grandpa. P.S. The Christmas tree is perfect. Good job, kids. P.S.S. Thank you for tidying up a bit.
Maybe I could use Steven's laptop? It's been ages since I've had news from the real world.
Danger. Really? I guess we can. Let me look around the rest of the house first. So they help put around decorations around and stuff. That door's closed now. They didn't leave him anything to eat. Throw some Pop-Tarts out or something. Well, it was literally...
Well... Maybe I could use the phone. It's been more than a month since I ditched my phone. Maybe the police stopped tracking us.
I don't think so. If I can do one thing, though, I'd want to go on the laptop. So let's go on the laptop and then see if we can use the phone. Oh, and then we can also just leave. Can we go out the back as well? Throwing rules out the window. We can just leave. Can't go that way. Just want to look at the tree.
We had a good time decorating the tree together last night.
I didn't get to take part in that.
Daniel loved it.
I guess I'll take your word for it. We can get to participate in that activity. I want to go check out the laptop. Breaking the law. Breaking the law.
I could just delete my browser history after I'm done.
Yeah, but they'll track you.
Jeez. Steven went search crazy on us. Look at this.
Oh, it's his browser history now. Or he left the page up. Seattle blast and shooting, an unresolved mystery. Officer Tanaka holds press conference on Seattle incident. SPD still considering every lead, including terror attack and gang fight. More questions than answers in Seattle incident as friends and neighbors mourn loss of local mechanic. Local mechanic. Was he hurt in the explosion? Who's the local mechanic? Seattle incident. Yeah, I don't know who the mechanic is.
These articles are almost a month old.
Where are the Diaz brothers?
Maybe they stopped looking for us?
No. This means it stopped being newsworthy. Doesn't mean the case is closed. I blacked out, says main witness of the Seattle blast after leaving a hospital. Seattle protests SPD, Seattle Police Department, to hold awareness workshop on racial bias. Thank you very much. Best article I've seen so far.
What the hell is this?
This.
Had no idea Steven could fall for this bullshit conspiracy theories.
Maybe he's not. Maybe he's just reading it. Unless he's writing stuff, too. I don't know. Sean Daniel Diaz, Seattle. Hey, is anybody following the Seattle shooting incident? There's a lot of weird things going on that nobody can explain. One, how did the police officer really die? Two, where did this mysterious explosion come from? Three, how did the fugitive brothers get around? Four, why are the police being so secretive with details? Discuss. If you have any inside scoop, please post here. Skidoo 66, or 68 rather, says, I've been all over this. Go to fakeexplosion.url for the first full story of this cover-up. The new power plant they want to build in the city is definitely part of that. Part of this. Looks like they just framed the poor kids, too. G.H. Pimp. I saw that surveillance footage, and there was no way that was a natural explosion. What is going on in Seattle? Maybe prepping for a false flag operation. Jill 101. I read that a motel owner saw the kids, and then he said kids blew up his toilet. Well, they didn't do that. Blew up the toilet. No, not the toilet. In the bedroom, moving things around like a whirlwind, but I don't think anything got seriously damaged. American Eye says, did you see the news report about the brothers at a gas station? Sounds sketchy. Madman says, not everything is a conspiracy, you U.S. wankers. Hipster Baby Doll says, my friend's parents work for the Oregon PD, and then they say there's a big secret manhunt for the two brothers. I heard they might have been used for experiments, but now they're on the run. Because the experiments worked and made them dangerous. I know there are experiments going on everywhere because I came from an experiment. Okay. That was funny. That's it? That's all we get? Visit. Oh, so the news is this, right?
Jeez. These articles. What the hell is this?
Alright.
Had no idea Steven could fall for this bullshit conspiracy theories.
Visit Brody's blog.
Well, Brody, if we ever make it home, wherever that is, you'll be much, much welcome.
A Tribe Called West, On the Edge by Brody Holloway, November 7th, 2016, Salt Lake City, Utah. This dispatch from Off the Road is a tribute to a couple new friends I made on a recent adventure that I've yet to transcribe or even fully process yet. I'll leave the details vague to protect the innocent because, believe me, they are not guilty, but let me digress. The best part about being a professional traveler, meaning I sometimes make gas money off these dispatches, is the people you meet on the proverbial road. Of course, the worst part about being a professional traveler is the people you meet on the actual road. I've been to lucky for a variety of reasons, though I've had moments of pant-crapping fear from the highway patrol hiding following me at night to that weird MF I picked up in Iowa who wouldn't leave the car. Read that awful account here. Ultimately, I approach strangers as potential friends, if not allies. I'm that naive and stupid that the universe feels sorry for me and lets me skate by as I help people on instinct rather than objectivity. First thought, best thought. I still hear my ex-brother, his choice, telling me years ago that you read all this Kerouac crap about life on the road, but you can't even change a tire. He was right, so I learned how to change a tire. I'm not good at it, so I also have towing insurance. End of dilemma. However, I can't always give my own version of roadside assistance, including to my young companeros who need it the most. I wish I could have done more for them, maybe even join their quest, because it's a more important journey than mine. Instead of just pushing a rock up a hill, I could have helped them move mountains out of the way. If we were hanging out again, I would ask them to forgive me for not coming along to offer whatever help I could. Then again, I'm kind of a clumsy dork, and I could have screwed stuff up by trying to play savior. The paralysis of analysis. My suspicion is they really didn't need me in the end, just each other. Right. Yeah. So I'll continue to weave this highway and roadside tapestry, always paying it forward. Call it guilt if you want. I'm still that geeky, sincere kid who looked up to anybody who wanted to change the world for good, who wanted to move mountains for others. I always wanted to be a car-bound Lois Lane, a roaming reporter, getting in the face of this corrupt matrix. Sure, my adult cynic knows the system is rigged, that we're screwed, and that justice is often just a joke. But when I saw the faces of my wandering friends who went through hell, and are still there for all I know, smiling with childlike gratitude at my most trivial of gifts, I felt ashamed, saddened. There were times when I encountered a little soul lost, and they flashed that wide-eyed, grateful, frightened stare, and you feel your heart break into a million pieces. Now I think of all those children out there alone in the night, on the precipice, the razor's edge of America and beyond, wanting only the most basic of life's needs like food and parents. It makes me cry and sick at once. Then I rage at the dying light and vow to do my part. That's the benefit of an activist on wheels. I always like to think of myself as moving forward, like a friendly shark. Otherwise we don't eat, we don't survive. Now I find myself thinking of the past, wondering if I gave the best advice to those in need. If I even help those lost children of the American night by leaving them on their own, then I realize that I'm the one who's actually lost out here. My friends climbing the hills know exactly where they're going, and I know you're going to make it home. I'd like to plan a visit.
Well, this article is much less creepy than it seemed back then.
This is the one he was working on when we visited at the gas station, I guess. The sky is almost a perfect blue cliché as I pull my weary gas beast off the winding Highway 5 into the tiny main vein of Rockville Springs, Wyoming, and at its community height, population 472. This is a stark, barren land before time, like any other sleepy town born from the local mine shafts that fed the community, along with the robber barons who owned the oil. The citizens suffered their fair share of tragedy over the decades, but managed to retain a healthy main street with a few thriving shops and services. But by the end of the oil star of 1970s, the once sleepy town was in a coma after the last drops of the precious earth blood had been mined. The company quietly closed shop and left the town and populace to their own devices, which meant most people packed up, closed shop, and left forever. Which brings me today to Rockville Springs, Wyoming, population 51, yet the ghosts who stayed behind to haunt what was left of the town are now stark naked. There was always an eccentric Lynchian aura over Rockville Springs, as demonstrated by their own nudist community, who'd been quietly amassing ever since the 1950s, after the first local oil first gushed from the earth. The town wasn't as religious or conservative as others in a repressive area, so the thought of nude volleyball didn't cause a legal scandal. How could it, when the city's own mayor was seen or unseen sunbathing in his birthday suit? So therefore nobody gave a rat's ass, even though they could see everybody's ass. When the majority of the town was abandoned, the nudist community saw this as their chance to to pursue the end goal, their lifelong dream, a naked public sphere free of moral judgment. Oh, brother. Okay, last page, though. But back in the future, i.e. 2016, the leftover, forgotten, and unclothed residents of Rockville Springs have come under some misguided public and political attacks for their au-naturel lifestyle. Thanks to smug media reports, curious visitors now drive through the depleted Main Street, not to get a cup of the damn fine pie and coffee at Raw Cafe, tell them Brody sent you, but to giggle and take selfies with the nude townspeople as their background props. It's rather gross to witness as I did my brief drive-through report. Yet there is no doubt some members of the town welcome the tourists because they spend money. There's that old expression, there's no such thing as bad publicity. Ironically, I'd heard about Rockville Springs in my travels and vowed to stop there someday, if only to satisfy my need to see a 56-year-old naked man change the oil in my car. Then I had a boring epiphany. How do you talk to a naked person? I find out you just talk. You don't forget the not wearing clothes, but you actually end up embarrassed that you are. The people I saw and chatted up didn't have any particularly unique insights into the world or geopolitics. As the mechanic told me, I give them taxes. Don't ask me to vote for the bastards, too. Ironically, some tended to be quite conservative. They just wanted to not pay taxes without clothes. Others seemed to stay out of sight with the crowds around, which makes the recent media circus more insulting, since the tone of the reports is always a condescending, "Ooh, look at the funny people with sagging flesh cooking eggs and jogging down the road." And full disclosure, I admit that the former Brody would not have been one of those same judgmental beeps. Glad I'm not him. Would have been one of the same judgmental beeps. Glad I'm not him anymore. Okay, take a breath, my dude. I'm not saying this mild condemnation is a great threat to liberty. We obviously have worse going on in this big country, but it's always a revealing microcosm of how we treat each other and all our naked hypocrisy. Do I dare?
Holy shit. Who are these assholes?
Alexa Stone.
That's some fucked up hate speech.
Okay, let me read it. This is on his page, I'm guessing. Yes, Sean Diaz, 05. Alexa Stone, cop killer. You can run, but you can't hide. Corey Alexander Jr. says, this is what happens when you let cockroaches in the kitchen. Strong Boy says, I've got a 38 bullet with you and your brother's name on it. Sleep tight, kids. Lyla Park says, I just reported you for death threats. He says, go back to China, dog eater. Oh my god. Why do you let just anyone, like, comment on your page like that? I know it might be something similar to Facebook, but anyone can comment. Clementine Kolschak says, Hi, Mr. Diaz. I'm a reporter for the Seattle Underground, and if you'd be interested in an off-the-record review to air your side of the story, please message me at your convenience. Thank you. Lila says, Thank you for your help. Sean and Daniel are not killers. You can contact me if you need info. Melissa Jane Roberts says, They don't deserve exposure. Lila Park puts a middle finger up. Emoji, I guess. American Citizens Coalition says, No more sanctuary cities.
Wow. Lila seems to be having a hard time. Never seen her this salty.
Lyla Park. Law and justice are not always the same, Gloria Steinem. Lyla Park shared her music video, The Limp Flamethrower. She shared a link, Seattle protests SPD to hold awareness workshops on racial bias. Cool story, bros. Guess what? Too late. Adam Barnes says, Hey, want to hang out at the park this afternoon? Sorry, dude. Not today. I can't click on these. Tried to.
I should really call Lyla to check on her.
Alright. Yeah, we're gonna break a rule. Let's break everything. The police are gonna be here shortly, I'm sure.
Just a quick call can't hurt us. I need to know if Lila's okay.
Yes?
Lyla? Hey. It's Sean.
Holy shit. No way.
How are you?
How are you?
Wow. You know, been better. I mean, you literally hung up on me. Sean, it's been weeks. How could you cut me off like that?
Lyla, I'm so sorry. We had to hide out for a while. Plus, I ditched my phone.
Never heard of payphones? I had to lie to the police for you, for fuck's sake. They grilled me for hours after your last call.
I'm sorry.
I'm so sorry. Thank you so much. I don't want you to get into any more trouble because of me. I better go.
No! Please, don't. Do not hang up on me. Not this time, dude. Talk to me. Please. How are you? How's Daniel?
We're all good, Lyla. Better than we've been for ages. I swear.
Okay.
Can't tell her where
now,
you are.
Where the hell are you?
Can't say. Somewhere safe.
Somewhere safe. Don't worry. Let's say we found some help. For now.
Really? That's what I wanted to hear. Sean. I kept seeing all these awful things happen to you.
I know. I'm sorry. Please tell me about you. About high school. Anything. Other than this fucking mess.
How's Jen?
Like, how's Jen? She texted me after... Well... She said her parents told her never to contact me again.
That figures. I don't hang out with her anymore. She ended up dating Derek.
Aw, man.
But she's way too cool for him. It's not gonna last.
Like I give a shit now. What about Lyla the Love Witch? Seeing someone?
No way! I'm way too busy trying not to lose my shit over you and Daniel. I've been really worried, Sean. I'm on medication.
What?
I couldn't sleep anymore.
Oh, fuck.
Damn.
You're gonna be okay, Lyla. So are we. But you have to be strong.
We'll see each other again.
We'll see each other again. We just have to wait until all this blows over and they forget about us.
You promise?
It might be a while, but I'll try when I can.
What's the statute of limitations?
Thank you for calling,
Sean. In Washington.
You literally saved my day.
It was so cool to hear your voice, Lyla. I gotta go look for Daniel now, but...
Statute of limitations in Washington probably never ends for someone who's murdered, like involving a murder. And, yeah, especially of a police officer.
I'm glad I called you.
Oh, man. I miss you guys so much. You better take care of yourself. My baby boy. Give him a big hug for me.
I will. You take care too, okay? Seriously. Love you, Lyla. Fuck. I really miss her. Stop thinking about that. Time to go get Daniel.
Yeah. Stop thinking about it. Good luck not thinking about it.
Okay. Let's get this brat back home now.
He got in trouble. Maybe the dad recognized him. Here's the maze.
Why does Daniel never listen? Maybe I'm too soft with him. And I thought Daniel was the crafty one.
Yeah. Sometimes you are. You give in to him too easily sometimes.
What the fuck?
Oh.
I'm gonna kill him.
That's not good. It makes no sense to be doing that, especially after what I've seen, but
Wonder what went on between this kid and his dad yesterday. It was pretty weird.
His dad was drunk off his ass.
Wow. Looks like someone paid the high price here.
Yeah, it was like M80s or something. Just looking around at the stuff we mess with in the prelude.
Steven and Claire are gonna freak if they realize he went to the Ericsons.
Oh, they sure will. That's a spaceship. Spaceman piss. Spaceman spiff. Let's see if they got any letters.
Single dad family. Way too close to home. Hmm. Wow. That's a lot of beer.
But there's some orange juice and milk too.
Daniel, what's going on here?
Sean, wait! Don't freak out. I can't explain.
Let me tell him. Sean, I know it sounds crazy, but I have a superpower. You saw me yesterday.
What?
I know you did. I was flying.
I can
move things, objects, with my mind.
Oh. Superpower.
He's making him think he has it.
Really?
Yes.
Who am I saying this to?
Great. And you don't realize what that implies? Everyone can see you from the outside. You could get in real trouble. This is dangerous. Do you understand?
Yes. We hear you. We promise to be careful.
This is just our secret, okay? Nobody can find out I'm the real Captain Spirit.
And nobody will. Ever.
Now you're an official member of the Spirit Squad. If you betray us, I'll disintegrate you. Nah, just kidding.
Charming.
Oh yeah, we need
a team signal. Totally! I'm gonna be Superwolf. What's your super name, Sean?
Los Lobo. El Diablo Loco.
I don't know. Something cool like El Diablo Loco.
Sounds like a supervillain's name. But okay.
Okay, guys, I think we're ready to roll.
Where are you rolling to?
Excuse me. Who are you?
I'm Sean.
Oh, yeah. Sorry, man. You're here for Daniel. Hey, let's make it official. I'm Charles Erickson.
Nice to meet you.
Hope you know that Daniel and Chris are a dangerous team. We better watch out, or they're gonna take over the world.
Yeah. They share a lot of things. As thick as thieves.
Can we go get the Christmas tree now? We're both ready to fly.
Yes, yes, yes. The team has been waiting too long. Hey, you should come along too. There's nothing going on over here.
Yes! Can't wait to see all the decorations! And Sean, we could buy Christmas presents for Grandma and Grandpa.
Sure.
Okay. Sure. I'll go with you guys.
Really?
Yeah! Cool.
Yeah, I just wish Chris and Daniel were excited about going. Okay, team, give me a time out to clean up the back seat. I'll honk when I'm done.
Ooh, can I use the bathroom?
Of course. Oh, you'll see my comic books. I'm glad you're coming too. Hey, you want to see my toys?
Oh, score! The new hot dog man?
Since you're a new member of the team, you have to know everybody. These are Captain Spirit's friends. And his enemies.
Dude, that's pretty cool.
Can you guess who are the good guys and the villains?
Let's see.
Well, the bear is definitely a hero.
Okay.
What are you talking about? Warrior is... Wait, there was a bear there. There's a bear here too?
Careful. It may be tricky.
That's the same bear. It's got moved over. Okay, heroes? The pirate has a name.
The bad guys, the good guys. Not that easy, right?
It's easy, little stinker. Hero. Villain?
Look closely.
Car is a villain. Insectoid is villain.
Interesting.
I got it right, dude.
Okay. How did I do?
Not bad. You're almost right.
What?
It was a bit tricky. Okay, let me introduce them to you. This is Team Spirit.
Oh, the dinos
are
here?
Guys. There's the Forest Warrior, Power Bear, Marty Rex, and Sky Pirate.
So, who are the bad guys?
That's Noctarius and the Shark Stinger. There's also Snowmancer, but he's out in the garden. Captain Spirit kinda took care of him. He might need a little surgery now. But they're all working for Mantroid, who is the real supervillain. You should see his evil planet.
Why doesn't Captain Spirit stop him?
He tried, but failed.
Yep.
That's why he needs Superwolf.
Failed.
You know, Daniel, to prevent Mantroid from hurting other people.
Yeah, strength in numbers. Sounds like Mantroid is in trouble.
Just wait until he sees what Captain Spirit can do now.
Yeah, about that.
What does Mantroid look like? Your father knows?
Does your dad know about any of this?